love you.
I love you forever. I love you forever. I love you forevermore.
Father, we thank you right now for what has happened already and what you're about to do through the word. Father, we thank you that we are sitting up under an open heaven. And Father, as the heavens are open, we just want to look up and lift our voices and say, we love you.
We love you, Father.
We thank you for all that you have done and all that you're going to do. Father, I expect miracles to happen today. I expect healing to take place. I expect the signs and the wonders of heaven to rain down in this earth realm. Father, we thank you right now for each and every person that is under the sound of my voice, even those that are joining by way of Periscope. Father, we thank you right now that you are going into their place where they are, that you are invading our space, Father. We thank you that anything that may be going on in our life, Father, that you make the course correction, Father, that we lean and we depend on you. We thank you and we love you. We thank you for the sound of heaven that is invading the earth. We thank you right now for salvation in the earth, Father. We thank you for just being who you are, for creating us in your image, Father. So we thank you right now. We praise you. And Father, we declare that if we walk in our apostolic and prophetic authority, Father, we declare in this house, your will be done in the earth as you've already made it to be in the heavenly realm. So we thank you right now. So Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in our sight. For you are my strength. You are my redeemer. You are my all and all. You are everything to me, Father. We thank you right now. Now, Father, I just decrease myself, and Father, I yield myself. Father, I yield the way to you. Father, I thank you as you go up and down every aisle. Touch every chair. Let every person here know that you are real, that you exist. Father, we thank you right now. And we'll not only praise your name right now, but Father, we'll praise your name from now until eternity. We thank you right now in your darling son, Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, we pray. Amen and amen. Come on, look at somebody and say, I bless you in Yeshua's name. All right, you just told me, everybody that's here that's not bilingual, you about to be bilinguals. Turn to somebody else and say, I bless you in Yeshua's name. Me always try to mess with that sound. That's why we got to proclaim that sound. That's why we have to let the sound go forth.
Hallelujah.
You know, when there's no expectation there, he's not expected to move. So in other words, he gave us a mouth for a reason.
Yes.
He inhabits the praises of his people.
Yes.
So when you shout hallelujah, you're just saying praise Yahweh. You're saying praise to the Most High, God, the creator of creation. I'm telling you that your life can change in the midst of your circumstances if you just open your mouth and just start praising it. Your doctor's diagnosis can change in the midst of you opening your mouth and saying thank you. Things can change. I'm telling you right now, thank you. I'm telling you, as you open your mouth, I just see course correction in the heavens. I'm telling you, I'm telling you right now, no, this is not a hype session. This is not a hype session. I'm telling you, things can happen. I see it already. Whether the enemy tried to take you out this morning, whether he tried to take you out this week, but when you open your mouth and you say, thank you for blocking the enemy. The more you open your mouth, the more praises come through. The more praises come through, I see healing and deliverance coming through. I see it. I'm not looking with my natural eye, y'all. I'm not looking with my natural eye. I'm looking in the spirit. I'm seeing healing taking place right now. I'm seeing people being reclaimed to salvation. I see backsliders coming back to you. I see it. Because I'm opening my mouth and I'm saying, Father, thank you. Hallelujah. Come on, you can do it. Y'all know I'm too big to be a cheerleader, so I can't do flips up and down this thing, but I tell you what, I can't say hallelujah. I can't say praise the Father. I can't say, I'm thanking him for bringing me out, y'all. Y'all have no idea. When you have an assignment, the enemy is always after you to take you out. When you are on assignment, it's the enemy's job to stop you. But you know, I always declare that the enemy is a lie, and I declare that Yahweh, who made me and who created me, who gave me the assignment, he, the greatest he that is within me, that thing that's within me shall the boast now and say, Father, thank you. I praise you right now for who you are. I praise you for who you are. I don't care what's going on. Y'all, I know y'all been through some trials and tribulations, but I guarantee you when you open your mouth and say, thank you. Thank you through my trials. Thank you through my tribulations. And he just want to see, can he trust you? Can he trust you with the light that he's giving you? Can he trust you? This is the time. Yeah, things happen. Things happen. Things happen. Things happen. I'm not, I know things happen. Things happen. Things happen. Things happen. Things happen. Things happen. But in the midst of all those things, I say, thank you, Father. I lift my hands in total adoration to you. You know, when I need help or when things are going on and I need help, it makes no sense for me to sit silently. It makes no sense. Sometimes I know as a man, as a husband, as a leader, I have to say help. Help me, Father. Guide me through these situations and these circumstances. If I keep my... He knows what you're in need of. He's just waiting for the sound to come out. Waiting for you to release. Yeah, I think we need another batch of that fresh oil. I think we need another batch of that fresh oil. I'm telling you, man, chicken tastes better in fresh oil. It sounds better when it's being cooked in fresh oil. So, Father, I say, Father, give me that fresh oil. I don't want to live off of last week's oil. The restaurants even know that they got to change the oil every day. Why is it that the believer think that they can live off of last year's oil? Father, give me fresh oil right now. Open your mouth and say, Father, give me fresh oil right now. Give me that oil, Father. Give me the oil. Father, give me the oil of joy. Give me the oil of healing. Give me the oil of deliverance. Father, give me the oil. Give me the oil. The oil. The oil to change my situation and my circumstances. Give me the oil, Father. Thank you for the oil. Thank you for the oil, Father. We thank you. We praise you. Oh, man. He's doing it. He's doing it. I'm grateful for the glory that filled the house. The glory that fills the house. The reason why the glory can fill the house is because we have made a declaration that the glory is going to fill the house. You should ask for the glory to fill my life, fill my body. Feel my life. Feel my body, y'all. This is not the time to be silent with all the crazy things going on all around the world. It's time for the believers to open their mouth and say, Father, give me the fresh oil. Give me the fresh oil. Give me that fresh oil. Give me that fresh oil. Give me that fresh oil, Father. Everything that I'm dealing with, Father, only you know what I'm dealing with, Father. And I thank you for the oil to deal with those things. Thank you for your oil. Thank you for your oil. Thank you for your oil. Amen. Come on, look at somebody else and say, I'm so glad to see you today. Come on, don't be selfish with you. Don't be selfish with it. Tell them, I'm so glad to see you today. To all of our guests that are here with us, we are grateful that Yahweh has given you and has blessed you to even come this way. We don't take it for granted that people come around here. You know, a leader is nothing without people that follow. They're just taking a walk. So we're grateful for those people that are here, for everybody that is in the sanctuary. I speak blessings over your life, blessings over your family. I speak blessings over your jobs, and if you have a business, I speak blessings over your business. Yeah, we can speak blessings over our, we're going to talk about that. Amen? Amen. Come on, look at somebody one more time and say, I'm glad to see you. You may be seated. It's all right. We family. Yes. Now, we have been dealing with the sound for the past couple of weeks. We've been really dealing, I'm telling you, Yahweh has really given us his grace and his glory to really dive into his sound and the sound. What does the sound have to do with me? Sound, as one of the ministers or the other right, somebody said, it's the reverberation of sound. That means that there's some wavelengths going out. Even when you put the instruments on reverb, there's a different sound that goes out. So that sound that he has given us can be the same sound that he gives us to heal us. Because we can be healed through a sound. Oh my goodness, y'all missing it. Y'all trying to tell you could be healed. The scripture declares that the death and life is in the power of what? The tongue, not just the physical tongue, but the sound that comes out. He's saying what you love is what you're gonna eat. If you always claim you broke, busted, and disgusted, you're releasing a sound of death over your life. Come on, y'all, I haven't even got to what I'm really gonna preach about. But we really got to understand the sound. That's why when we come through this, when we come through the over the threshold, we have to be thankful. There has to be a thankful sound, the sound of life. Yeah. Really, regardless of what you're going through, there has to be that sound that you release. Y'all, we know. I know that things are happening. We look here. I'm human also. Like I said, the devil is always trying his best to take us out. But I would not give him. I would not give him the ammunition to do it. How do you give them ammunition? What you agree with? What your sound of releasing? Amen. For those that say that they are sick, Yahweh said that the I am said that I am healed, that you are healed. You can't keep claiming that I'm sick. Yeah, you keep claiming you're going to stay sick. That's the job of the enemy, to keep you in a place of bondage. To keep you in a place where you cannot release the sound. You cannot release the sound. That's why when you're in a place of worship, when you're in a place of praise, it's mandatory for you. If you want to shift something, create a sound that's going to shift. If you really want to shift your atmosphere, you got to create that sound. Y'all know y'all listen to music, and y'all listen to praise and worship, and even for those that listen to secular music, that secular music is creating a sound atmosphere around you. That's why I learned at an early age that as a child, as children, is the reason why the scripture tells us to train up a child, because children they don't have filters. They don't have filters, so anything, any sound that they hear, they try to mimic that sound. Yeah, y'all know. Y'all done seen them places where the parents, you know, the parents cursing. The children start cursing. They think it's okay because there's a sound that's reverberating throughout the place where the children are. So we have to understand that we got to create the sound of worship. We got to create the sound of praise. Every person on this earth is made to worship. I don't care if you're atheist. I don't care if you're satanic. I don't care if you worship Buddha, Hammurabi, whoever. Every person was made to worship. But the thing is who are you worshiping? What sound are you creating when you're worshiping? That's why it's so important that everything has to align with the scripture. Now, there's different types of sounds. There's different modulations of sound. There's happy sounds. There's sad sounds. There's so many different sounds that we hear. But the Father said, what sound are you producing? What sound is coming through your body? What are you saying about your family? What are you saying about your job? What are you saying even about your church? What are you saying? What sound? Am I creating the sound of healing? Am I creating the sound of worship that will evoke healing upon my mind, my understanding? You know, am I creating that sound that brings forth deliverance? Deliverance, continual deliverance. Amen. What type of sound am I bringing forth today? You know, as I was listening to a prophet that she preached on last Shabbat, oh my goodness. See, I'm still grateful that we have a place to come and worship in. After that message, she talked about the sound of heaven. And as she was, I'm so glad that we are one, that we're married, that we're one. And sometimes when she's talking, the Holy Spirit will give me something at that instance that will correlate and that will line up with what she's saying, that will keep us in the same lane. Amen. Because, as a married couple, we have to make sure that we are on the same course, that we sleep in the same bed, that we talk the same talk, that we are pronouncing the sound of wholeness in every area of our marriage, that we are allowing the holiness, set apartness, to be the sound of our marriage, so that we can tell you and you see the benefits of being of the sound of wholeness and holiness being preached. So today, we're going to talk about shifting a nation through the holy sound. Shifted. I'm telling you, that came from when she was speaking upon the sound coming through the heavens. I'm like, man, a lot of times that the Father is speaking to us, but there's so much stuff going on in clouds. We got situations and circumstances. We're not worried about the first and the 15th. There's always somebody that's speaking negatively that we have allowed in our sphere around us. And therefore, when the Holy Spirit is trying to speak to us and trying to give us direction and trying to give us a strategy, it's being out, so many things are going on that we can't decipher what the sound is or who's speaking or why they're speaking. So, he told me we need to understand that we need to get rid of the negativity and we need to get rid of so many of the things that block out the Holy Spirit, that block out his voice. Now, in speaking about shifting a nation, now you have to understand what a nation really is. I remember this old saying, it takes a village to raise a child. It takes a village. And when I began to study about the seven nations in Deuteronomy 7, now I don't talk about that, right? But when I began to understand that the Perizzites are one who believe in village, they're village people. In other words, when you speak about a village, you are closed-minded. It limits you. The village limits you. So the Holy Spirit say, no, you are a nation.
Yeah.
You are a nation. Yeah. You are a nation of people. He didn't bring a village of Israel out. He brought a nation of Israel out. In other words, out of your belly, out of the seed that you, that when man and woman procreate, they create a nation.
Yeah.
So come on, say, Father, thank you that I am a nation. Come on, y'all. Okay. I am a nation. I am here to change and to shift things because of the nation that is inside of me. Not, I'm just a man. He created, he gave me the ability and put seed in me. So when seed is released, whether it be verbally or however he releases the seed of a nation comes out. I can't play myself small. Because he's made me to be above and not beneath. He's not closing my mind. He said that, you know, according to Romans 12:2, we can't think like the world. Our mind has to be transformed because of our understanding. If my understanding is telling me that I am less than, therefore I will act, and that's what I produce. What is less than, and that's what's happening with this world. You know, we're so caught up in behind the presidential things, thinking that, wait a minute, Yahweh's created me to be a nation. I have access to the one that created this whole thing. Somebody just, the scripture just said in Bereshit, in Genesis, let there be, or he created, he said, let there be, therefore the earth came, so therefore I have direct access to the one who said that I am a nation, and he said, through my mouth, things can change. I think three people believe that. Let me say it one more time. Because greater is he that's in me than that thing, than those things that are in this world that try to keep us down, those things that try to keep us in bondage. I am greater. So therefore, what comes out of my mouth, there is a nation that comes out. So I said, Father, okay, we got to really deal with this nation thing because we got to shift some things that's going on in this earth realm. And he said, I've given you the power to shift it. But this has to be a consistent shift. He can't be Yahweh don't deal with, God don't deal with hit and miss. He don't deal with hit and miss. He deals with consistency. After he said after the world was formed, he said, let there be light, and then he said, let the water come forth. And then he said that was a consistency that was coming forth because first of all, he wasn't thinking small. He wasn't thinking like a villager, a small villager that's only limited was to their surroundings. The village is only limited to the surroundings, but the nation. He made it. That's right. He made us a limitless people, which means that we are more than. We have more than. But we have to be in a place where we are consistently taught who we are. If I'm consistently taught that I can, that healing is the children's bread, therefore I accept healing. Be the children's bread. I'm not worried about what the doctor say. I'm grateful for the doctor. He's there for a reason. Glad he went through school, but he got to pay his bills, so he got to tell you a certain thing. So therefore, I don't just have to align myself with the word of the doctor. I'm grateful that the doctor is here to literally tell you what you need to pray for. Here to tell you what you got to pray for. If you got some foreign things going on in your body, you know what to pray for now. It don't mean that you align with those things. And see, when people begin to align and they begin to believe what the doctor say, you always notice that, you know, things take a shift real fast. So because I am a nation, because the greater is in me, I can literally live in a realm of healing. I can live in a realm of wholeness. Because he's given me to be a nation, and because I am a nation, I can shift things around me, but I have to listen to the holy sound. Why do you say a holy sound? Because a holy sound is a set apart sound. It's not the bill collector calling you. That's not a holy sound. And, you know, pay your bills, okay? Do that. But that's not it, because some people are rattled when they don't even answer the phone, because they're rattled because they think of what this person's going to tell them on the other end. But I can answer the phone when the telemarketer calls. I can add, because he's given me the power. And I tell you what, whenever the telemarketer calls you next, you just start prophesying. Just start speaking in tongues on the phone. Get them saved if they're not saved already. There you go. Okay. A nation. A nation is a large aggregate of people united by common descent, history, culture, or language, inhabiting a particular country or territory. A nation is stated, you know, is started. A nation is started by one person, but that one person multiplies. And it begins to be more and more and more. We have to understand that we have more power, literally, especially in the spiritual realm, than the president does. Than any of the other 45 presidents that's been in existence. We have more power than they have. And see, the thing is, we can't be those mimicking, complaining type people. Thank you, Lord. That's what I'm there for. Those murmuring and complaining type people. You know, you can't be murmuring about things, because I always think about the story of Nebuchadnezzar. Even when the king thought he was more than, even when the king thought that he was the one making the sun rise and he's the one making the moon descend, even when the king thought that he was the one that was ruling everything, even though Yahweh came down and touched his mind. Yeah, and made him start eating grass. And made him walk on four legs. Or made him walk on all fours. See, that's why you got to understand that Yahweh got all this stuff in control. I don't care what people say. They can talk. I'm not worried or I'm not rattled. You know, people have issues. We all have issues. We all need to be saved. We all need to be sanctified and lived and filled with the Holy Spirit. We all need to go through that. That one person don't rule or does not control my life. He put me here for a reason, and I have to hear what his sound is saying for me, the church family, and those who are around me, so that he's steering us in a clear direction. And so, as the Holy Spirit was dealing with me about this and about this sound he's dealing with me about shifting the nations through this set apart sound, one of the people that he literally had me to really study was Samuel. Samuel, perfect example. And if you go to 1 Samuel, the first chapter, it start off with Hannah. You know, Hannah being childless, and Hannah was being tormented by Peninnah, because Peninnah had children. They were married to the same person, but yet that was a torment that happened. And Hannah ends up, you know, speaking to Eli about what's going on in her life, and and things that are happening, and she's always sad, but she's there during the time of you know, when the altar is laying the animals before the altar. She's there for sacrificial purposes, and she's there, but she's mad, she's crying because she don't have children, and that she wants children. She wants to be able to be fruitful and multiply. And so here it is, she's, and Eli's speaking to her, and I'm kind of going through this situation. And I want you to read 1 Samuel, the first chapter, because it's a great story. It's a great story because what happens is she begins to talk to Eli. And Eli, first of all, thinks she's drunk, something is wrong with her. Because, you know, why are you always crying? Why are you always, you're not eating, you're just looking terrible. What's going on with you? And she explains, and she's really praying to Yahweh to give her a son. I'm going through this. And so in verse 6 of verse 7, it says, moreover, her rival also provoked her greatly to make her irritable because Yahweh had shut up her womb, and that's the plan of the enemy to always, he's just trying to irritate you about things. Trying to make you see that there's no end to this thing. Trying to make you see that something is wrong with you, that it cannot be reversed. But here, Yahweh, being the creator of creation, you know, he has the last say so. It's not about what people do to you. It's about how you respond to what they do to you. It ain't about that. It ain't about what they do to you. If your response, see, her response was that, look, I know I need a child. I need a child because, you know, I want to love on somebody, but guess what? If I have this child, I will dedicate him to you, Yahweh, because I know you gave him to me. That's what we have to understand. That's what we have to understand, is that when we are in a situation where things are looking bleak, where things are looking crazy, and we're praying, we have to first go through the process. Go through the process. Go through the process and see. You can't, this is not a microwave type situation, because you know, in order for her to have a child, that she has to go through the process. So after she goes home, they go through the process. Because even the scripture says they went through the process. So, and sometime later, they came back, and she said that she was going to leave. She's going to dedicate her son. Now, this all plays, everything works. Romans 8 and 20 say all things work together. All things. Regardless of how it looks, regardless of how it sounds, regardless of what people say, what people do, all things work together. For who? For those who love. Not for those who just casually visit him. Not for those who only want a weekend relationship with him. Yeah. All things work together for the good for those who love him. And they are called according to, not your purpose. See, that was a purpose for Samuel. Let me say this again. When things look crazy, that is a purpose that the Father has put into you to take care of a future need. See, Samuel wasn't just for her. Samuel was for a future need. So yeah, you gotta go through the process. You gotta go through this process. Even when the enemy is provoking you, you still gotta stay the course. Because she could have easily said, you know what, it ain't working between me and you. She could have told her husband, it ain't working between me and you. I need to go somewhere else. The prophet didn't say this, the prophet didn't say that, and I didn't got this. See, all of a sudden, you start saying what people didn't say. And so you start making up stuff. That's why you gotta watch what people say. Oh, the Lord said, you gotta make sure who know what Lord are they talking about. Okay, let me get up. So what happens is, and this is very important. In verse 24 of 1 Samuel, the first chapter, it says, and when she had weaned him, now at this time Samuel is born, because they went through the process, and she says she took him up with her with 3 bulls, 1 ephah of flour, and a skin of wine, and brought him to the house of Yahweh in Shiloh. Now, I actually visited that place. We visited that place in Shiloh. We were there. It's a great place. Now, once again, you got to understand, they didn't just walk into a building like you walking in here. They had to climb up a mountain. Okay. So, in other words, if you really want to see that, they really wanted to worship the Father, because they literally went up a steep mountain. They carried their livestock, and they carried all these things up a mountain. See, by the time we got there, they built some stairs. Even the stairs were steep. My God! The stairs were steep. So I have a great respect for everybody that went to the temple to go and sacrifice something, because they didn't just get in their car and just drive across the street, or they didn't get in their car and drive across the town. They literally had to walk up a mountain. That's it. That says something. What are you willing to risk to worship the Father? Because you got to go through this process. You got to go through this process. Now that she's went through the process, now her and her family, they're walking up this mountain, walking up a mountain, basically climbing a mountain. And what she did was she brought an offering. See, she understood the process she went through, and therefore she had to bring an offering to the Father for blessing her, because he promised her. He made a promise. That's why, yeah, you know, in Numbers it said that God is not a man that he should lie. Not the son of man, he got to repent. If he said it, he's going to bring it to pass. So therefore, she brings an offering. She brings three bullocks and one ephah of flour and a skin of wine. The three bullocks they were a burnt offering. The second for a sin offering. And the third, one bullet was for a burnt offering. The second one was for a sin offering, because y'all know she was in there crying and tripping. So she had to repent. And then the third was a peace offering. The third bull represents a peace offering. Okay, y'all, okay. So therefore she understood that when she came before the Father, that she knew that she had to repent. And that's the thing, that as we want to shift the nation, if we ourselves need to be shifted, we have to repent. Oh, Father. Y'all don't be no type of people that be like, what I got to repent for? You need to repent for that. Repent for thinking that you don't have to repent. Repent for thinking that. So she understood. She brings it up because she knows that she's crying and she's going off, and even for the priest to think she was drunk, that something really bad had to have gone on in her life. And this was on a consistent basis. So how in the world is the nation inside of her want to change if she don't change? She understood that she had to bring forth an offering in order to shift that nation into the right alignment of the Father. The flour was for the meal, and it was an offering that belonged to the principal sacrifices, which to each bullet were 3/10 deals, or 3/10 parts of an ephah. An ephah is an ancient Hebrew word that means a dry measure that is equivalent to a bushel. Equivalent to a bushel. So remember, y'all, they walking up a mountain. Y'all gotta understand, when your worship is real, baby, nothing can stop you. When you know that sound is real in you, can't nothing stop you from getting to that place of worship. Yeah. And so a ninth part of the ephah was spent, and the tenth part was given to the priest. Now the wine was for a drink offering. 1 Samuel 1:25 says, and they slaughtered a bull and brought the child to Eli. So let's go to the second chapter. 1 Samuel, second chapter. You know, it talks about how Hannah exalts Yahweh in prayer. And verse 12 says, Eli's son misused their sacred office, and they misused the sacred office for the offering that was put forth. We're talking about Hophni and Phinehas. Hophni and Phinehas. Y'all know that they was raping the women. Mind you, they were married. These were sons of the priests. See, that's what I'm saying. That the thing that Yahweh has put inside of you is for future use. Because the temple has got to get right. So now, we got to go through this whole spiel. We got to go through this whole spiel of Hophni and Phinehas just going through, taking the best parts of the sacrifice for themselves. Taking the best parts for themselves, not even offering up to the God they say they serve. They're taking it. They're basically making their own barbecue. That's what they're doing. They're making their own barbecue. You know, they know that the people are to come and bring the sacrifice, which was some bulls, some pigeons, and all these things. And so they thought, you know what? I could use this for myself. I could feed my family with all this, and it was not meant for them, because Yahweh had already set aside a portion for the priests. So when the priest began to double dipping, So the priest begins to be double dipping, and now Yahweh is not pleased with this situation. Now he's not pleased. And then while the priest is double dipping, that means that the sacrifice that was for that person did not go through. Here it is, I think that my sacrifice was made, and therefore it wasn't made correctly. So therefore, some things begin to happen. I'm trying to figure out why things are happening, because the sacrifice didn't go through, because the people who we trusted for the sacrifice, they're the ones that stole our money, and it makes it, gives it a bad name for preachers nowadays, these pulpit pimps and all these other people that go around that manipulate the people of Yahweh. So when you come up into a place like this, all of a sudden you look and say, oh, what's going on here? What they, you waiting on, see, that's, all of a sudden you waiting on something bad to happen because of what has happened in times before. No, this, it's not like that here. That's not like that here. You look here. Because of the God that we serve, look here, I know if he just let that rain down fire, when the man that put water on the altar rained down fire, I believe he can do it now. I've heard too many people that got struck by lightning. Minding their own business. I know too many preachers that have died in the pulpit. So therefore, my relationship, I love Yahweh and I would never cross him, nor would I cross his people. Amen. So when you're dealing with people like this, you begin to wonder what's going on. And you still got to remember that there has to be a nation that has to be born to shift the atmosphere, to shift what's going on. Because these two nations right here driving people straight to hell. Yeah, you can use a nation to be great, or you can use a nation to destruct. Why you think there are wars and rules and wars all around? Because they feel like that their nation should be in control, not following the words, and they're not following the scripture. They're not filled with the Holy Spirit, so they feel like this is my land and they need to get off the land. Okay, let me go back. So, 1 Samuel 2 and 17 says, and the sin of the young men was very great before Yahweh. For the men despised the offerings of him, of Yahweh. Verse 22 of 2 Samuel, the second chapter, says, and Eli was very old and had heard all that his sons were doing to all of Israel, and how they lay with women who were assembling at the door of the tent of meetings. He heard this. He heard it. He knew what was going on, but didn't do anything about it. You continue to allow your children to desecrate the temple. This is why we believe in we believe in discipline. No, we're not talking about beating discipline. No, we talk about discipline according to the Holy Scripture. Because when you allow these people, and you know they're not doing any good, they're doing more harm, Yahweh's looking. God is looking. So he knew, Eli knew that his sons were going on. And guess what? Now it's time for him to be judged. Second chapter, the 27th verse says, And a man of God came to Eli and said to him, thus said God, did I not clearly reveal myself to the house of your father when they were in Mithraim in Pharaoh's house? And then you go down to verse 29 and says, why do you kick at my slaughterings and my offerings, which I have commanded in my dwelling place, and esteem your sons? You put your sons above me. You put your son, in other words, you put everything in your life above God or above Yahweh. You have no respect for me, is what he's saying. And so he says, to make yourselves fat with the best of all the offerings of Israel, my people. And this is why in Proverbs, the 13th chapter, 24 verse says, he who spares his rod hates his son. He who spares his rod, and don't discipline, you literally saying you hate. But he who loves him seek with discipline. You can be working while, and this is what Yahweh told me, you can be working and you're fired, yet you're fired. Yeah. You got two people working, don't even know that the end is near. Yeah. don't have no clue that their benefits about to get revoked. So then you go to 1 Samuel, the second, to the 30th verse. It says, therefore, Yahweh Elohim of Israel declares, I said indeed that your house and the house of your father would walk before me forever. But now Yahweh declares, far be it from me. For those who highly esteem me, I highly esteem, and those who despise me are lightly esteemed. See, the days are coming that I shall cut off your arm and the arm of your father's house, so that an old man not be found in your house. And you shall see an enemy in my dwelling place, despite all the good which Elohim does for Israel. And there shall not be an old man in your house forever, but any of your men whom I do not cut off from my, come on, preach with me. Cut off from my altar is to consume your eyes and grieve your life, and all the increase of your house die as men. He's basically pronouncing death over Eli and his son. Because he placed his son over the Creator. Here it is. So this is why Samuel got to come forth. Samuel got to come forth. For the future, because that the temple have to be set back in order. It has to be set back in order. And in verse 36 says, and it shall be that everyone who is left in your house shall come and bow down to him for a piece of silver and a cake of bread and say, please put me in one of the priestly positions to eat a piece of bread. Now, here we go to chapter 3. Chapter 3, the call of Samuel. And in verse 4 it says, and Yahweh called Samuel and he answered. See, now it's saying that his ears was not tuned to the Most High. You got to understand something. During this time, the prophetic office was not as strong as it is now after Samuel. Samuel put a lot of things in place. But Samuel's ears were always fixed and attuned to Eli, the human thing. And here it is, and he runs off into the room, and he said, here am I. And Eli had to sit him out and say, look, okay, you've been done this too many times. I need you to go lay down and basically say, speak to the Lord. Now the father is fixing his ears and fixing his faith, because now he's about to be shifting, because he's about to shift. Yeah, he's listening. See, this is the thing. See, we could be hearing a sound, but we don't know the sound that we're hearing. That was a sound that came straight from the heavens, and he could not recognize the sound that he was hearing. Why? Because there was so much other stuff that was going on. You had these guys up here wreaking havoc in the temple. They raping people, killing, and they up there eating up all the portions. Too much going on. But yet Samuel did not participate in any of the foolishness. See, then he could have easily picked up after these guys, but yet Yahweh preserved him. God had him preserved for a reason. And here it is, when he hears the sound again, he says, here am I, and then the father begins to tell him about the destruction that's about to come upon the house. I'm about to reposition you. And see, that's what we got to be listening for, the sound of repositioning, so that we can put our nations that come up out of us in the right place. So now, he's about to shift. He's about to shift. The prophetic anointing was brought into this level of functioning and maturing through Samuel's life. Before the days of Samuel, the prophetic anointing was a patriarch. What's called the patriarch. It was a patriarch type of anointing, which could only be transferred through the natural sonship and lineage from Abraham to Isaac and then to Jacob. Yet none of the Jacob's sons moved fully in the prophetic. The only one that did was Joseph. Joseph. This is why we have to know the nations that are inside of us, so that we could align them right. See, Samuel was the prophet and the priest, and he was a king and as a prophet. Now he's aligning. Now he's shifting Israel, because he was a divine oracle that continually put Israel in the right place. And as a priest, he made sure that he took out all the idol worship that was in Israel. See, this is what for future prophecies. this earth for a purpose. Are you finding your purpose? Are you shifting the nation? Are you bringing the people into the alignment of the Father? Are you speaking salvation? Are you speaking healing? Are you hurting people? Yeah, you have to know what your purpose is. See, while Yahweh was talking to Samuel through that dream of when he got up and he was talking to him, he began to tell him his purpose. See, sometimes you need to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning. And while you're up at 3 o'clock in the morning, you need to say, Father, what's my purpose during this night watch? You need to see what's going on in my neighborhood, Father. Well, what purpose do I have to shift my neighborhood back to the alignment of you to get rid of all this idol worship? So you're here for this purpose. You're here to shift. You are a nation that will shift other nations. It is my job to shift you into the place where you need to be. Are you ready to be shifted? Are you ready to be aligned with the Holy Spirit? Is your ears ready to be attuned to what he's saying to you? Yeah, sometimes you got to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning and pray. Sometimes you got to steal away from the table to hear, to really get yourself, your body in alignment, to hear what he has to say. Because remember, it's not just for you, it's for somebody that's around you. You're there to shift somebody else. Are you willing to shift that person? Are you going to be selfish? Are you just going to be crying and complain about your situation and your circumstances? Remember, you can change your situation and your circumstances through your sound. When you understand that I'm the head and not the tail, that brings about something. That's a different sound right there. Yeah. See, when I walk up into a place, if I want to buy a car, I'm not going in there to buy a car thinking that I'm less than. See, they don't know what's in your pocket. They don't know what's in your bank account. They have no idea who you are. But if you go in there begging and borrowing and all this other type of stuff, then you have yet given them the power. So what I'm saying is, when I go to the doctor, I'm not going to the doctor for him to just speak some stuff over me. Tell me what I need to know so I can be praying. Because I'm here to shift a future generation. I'm here to shift the generation of now. You have to be careful as you're hearing the sound. What sound that you're hearing is, as Eli had to tell Samuel to go back, listen again. It's not me. It's you're about to be aligned. You have to be careful of the people that you allow to speak into your life. How is that? Because there was once a story in Genesis 11 that talked about a person that led a whole bunch of people because he was king. They listened to him. They trusted him. They said, he told those people, look here, we're going to settle right here and we're going to build a tower that goes into the heavens. His whole purpose for building that tower was to show the people that he was God. See, that's why you have to be in tune to what the Holy Spirit is saying. And then here comes y'all. He said, you know what? They think they're smart. Because they're on one accord. They all speak in the same language, so there's a certain sound that's going up. They think they got it all together. You know, they have all these masons and everybody building bricks and setting stones in order. And they got to a portion where y'all would say, let's go down there. Let's confuse the sound. You got to watch out because he had to come and confuse the sound. And now sound could be, whether it be a musical sound or whether it be someone talking, or sound could be different things. So he had to confuse the people. Because he's even Yahweh said, wait, they're working together. They're working together. Now, what would it be like if we all created this one sound in this building? Now, they were doing it here with the praise and worship team. They were creating that sound, and you saw things begin to happen in the atmosphere. You heard chains being destroyed. And you start that, what happens when we all create that one sound, when we hear the sound of heaven? When we hear that sound of heaven that says that, you know, that you are my chosen people. You are a royal priesthood. You are a set apart nation. What happens when you hear that sound? And when that sound comes forth into the earth, and you align yourself with that sound. See, this is when we to see the healings and the miracles and all the things when we get out of ourselves. Regardless of what I'm going through, I'm getting out of myself because I'm aligning with a sound. I'm aligning with what the Father said that I'm ahead. I can't align with those people that said that I wouldn't live to be 25. I can't align with those people that said that I'd never go to college. I can't align with those people that said that I was dumb as a bag of rocks. I can't align with those people that said that I was ugly. I can't align with those people that kept saying that I was a tail. I can't align with that sound. And I'm here to tell you, you don't have to align with that sound of people telling you that you are less than. You have to know that greater is He that's in me, that I'm more than a conqueror. I'm more than, come on, I can declare that because I am a nation. I am a set apart nation. I am more than a conqueror. I am more than a conqueror. See, you got to keep telling your children that you are more than a conqueror. That you are more than a conqueror. That you shall live and not die and declare the worst of the Father. Even when the doctor does say what he says, I automatically declare that I'm going to live and not die. I'm going to declare the works of the Father. I refuse to leave this earth before my time. When I leave this earth, you're going to know that He has poured out everything that He was born with. Because I know that the Father created me to be a limitless person. I will not limit myself just to make somebody else feel good. I will not dumb down myself just because people don't want to rise up to who they're supposed to be. You got to keep declaring to yourself that I'm above and not beneath. That I'm a nation that's set up on a hill that will not be healed. You got to declare to yourself. And not only declare, you got to walk in it. I don't care who you are or where you are. You got to walk in who you are. You got to walk in knowing that I'm a nation that every time I walk up into this room, I'm here to shift the atmosphere. Yeah. I'm not going to bow down to what people are saying and to what people are doing. I'm here to shift this atmosphere through a holy sound, through a set apart sound. I'm here to tell you things are beginning to change right now. Things are changing your life when you start releasing that sound because you know who you are. You got to know who you are. Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? See, I just thought I was just a Patricia Anderson son, but I'm more than Patricia Anderson's son. I'm more than Adolphus Anderson's son. He's made me to be high. He's put me in high places, in heavenly places, high above principalities. Therefore, I don't have to get into chicken fights no more. Yes, because I'm a nation set apart, that He has placed me high. Therefore, I don't have to worry about what the first and the 15th have to say. I control the first and the 15th. I say that my bills are paid ahead of time. I say that I'm healed. I say that I'm whole. That's what I say I am. You have to declare to yourself that's who you are. You got to declare to yourself that's who you are. I'm going to walk in my heavenly place. I'm going to walk as He told me to walk. I'm listening to His sound. He's good. He's good. Come on, He's good. Because He's made me a nation. He's made you a nation. He's good. Walk in your nation. Walk in your holy nation. Tell everybody you come in contact with, I'm a holy nation. I'm set apart. I ain't got to deal with all the shenanigans that's going on in this world. We understand that the president is going through all these things, but somebody needs to tell the president that I am a nation all to myself, and I am here to shift other nations. Not just a body of land. We're talking about a body of people. A body of people. Carry this message with you. Regardless of what happens to you, I don't care what goes on. You tell that devil when he try to get up in your face, first of all, I'm a king's child. And therefore, He has created me to be a nation. Everything I need is in Him. In Him I live, in Him I move, in Him I have my being. So therefore, I pray that the Father has blessed you with this word and that you will walk in who you are supposed to be and who He has created you to be. He has created. And don't listen to anybody. You have to have the gift of discernment. You have to have discernment to know who the Father has called you to be. Amen. Come on, stand to your feet.